De'Aaron King has decided that he is going to grad transfer to Miami, and we got to talk about it after the bumper.
Don't be cornering me. Hold up. Time. You got to help me with that corner sh**.
What's up, kinfolk? It's RJ Young. I am not on a step mill. Consider hitting the like and subscribe button because I upload a video every single day. It's always college football related, sports related. We have a good time today. We need to talk about Houston quarterback De'Aaron King choosing to grad transfer to the University of Miami. This according to The Athletic's Manny Navarro, who said De'Aaron King told the coaches at Miami he plans to choose them and then enroll on Tuesday. So now we know where the most coveted commodity in the college football grad transfer window is deciding to go. So that means that LSU is off the board. Arkansas is off the board. Mississippi State, for those of you that thought that was a fit, I don't know how you really thought that was a fit, but you did. He's off the board. Miami is somewhat a quizzical choice, but only if you don't really understand the hiring of Rhett Lashlee. And I think that has as much to do with De'Aaron King choosing Miami as anything else. Manny Diaz fired Dan Enos after one season of running his pro-style offense where they really couldn't do much of anything, in part because of the quarterback play, yes, but also in part because they gave up 51 sacks in 13 games, man. That's not going to be very good. We know that the offensive line was inexperienced, but we also remember them getting destroyed by Florida in their opener, and it didn't get much better throughout the rest of the season. So you hire Rhett Lashlee, and in hiring Rhett Lashlee, you hired the architect of an offense that led SMU to its first double-digit win season since 1984. 35 years since the last time Southern Methodist was good. Add to that, they averaged 41 points per game, 489 yards of offense a game, and then throw in there that he did this with Shane Buechele at quarterback, who threw for damn near 4,000 yards, 3,929, with 34 touchdowns and just 10 interceptions. Damn good, especially when you throw in there they had three receivers go for at least 700 yards receiving. But my favorite stat about that SMU offense that Rhett Lashlee was the offensive coordinator for is that they had 50 plays or more of 30 more yards explosive. So at least 50 plays with at least 30 yards gained on them. The only teams with more were Central Florida and Oklahoma. So you know that Rhett Lashlee's version of Gus Malzahn's offense works. And that's also important because he's not just a Gus Malzahn disciple. He played quarterback in this system for Gus Malzahn in high school. That's how embedded Rhett Lashlee is with Malzahn, having coordinated for him, having been at UConn. We all know about how that went. Ends up at Southern Methodist. Sonny Dykes and them do the turnaround. Now, throw De'Aaron King in the mix, and you get a guy who was responsible for 50 touchdowns the last time he played a full season of football. So you know what you're getting there, but you also are getting a man who is used to running around and making things happen, and he might have to do that with this offensive line. Now, we all expect him to be gooder. Did I just say gooder? My God. I got to stop talking for a living. We all expect them to be better in 2020, but I don't expect them to be great. Now, you'll also get the Jalen Knighton, who I really, really like, pass catching out of the backfield in this and getting the running backs involved in a pass-heavy offense. But you also get Jeremiah Payton off the red shirt. I expect him to be really good. That was a consensus four-star recruit that they decided to redshirt. I don't know what this means for Jaren Williams and Tate Martell and Nicosi Perry. Now the quarterback room is really crowded, and you got to believe that De'Aaron King is going to be your de facto starter come week one. Does that mean that Tate Martell moves to wide receiver, play a little slot? Maybe. But what does that mean for Jaren Williams, who is absolutely a quarterback? I'm fascinated to see what this means because also you get all these grad transfers and these transfers out of the portal that are going to be eligible for Miami in 2020, highlighted by the number one recruit in 2017, Jalen Phillips, who decided that he was going to leave UCLA and come to Miami. You could really talk me into Miami winning 10 games this year. Not because I think that Miami's going to be some sort of juggernaut because of Rhett Lashlee and De'Aaron King, but because the schedule is kind of watered down, y'all. There's just not a whole lot going on in there. Their toughest games are at Michigan State and also perhaps Pitt, North Carolina. And depending on how you feel about Wake Forest, Sands, store brand Cam Newton, who's now the quarterback in Georgia, you could see them going 10-2, 10-3, and getting beat down in an ACC championship. You know, you could see that. This is Clemson's conference. We all know this, right? But Florida State is in a rebuild year with a first-year head coach and Mike Norvell. Maybe they'll be able to do something, but I doubt in this first year. Vatek is in such a mess that their head coach went to interview for the job at Baylor, then didn't get it. So things going to be real awkward up there in Blacksburg for a little bit. Also at the end of the Bud Foster era. So that part of the ACC is wide open. But I also know that Manny Diaz needs to make this work. Remember, this time last year, Diaz had just taken the Miami job after being the head coach of Temple for all of like 17 days. And then Mark Richt decided to step down. They said, hey, Manny, you want the job? And he said, deuces, Temple. I'm going back to Miami. So Miami has been just a comedy over the last calendar year because now we got Dan Enos who's out there going, yo, man, for real? I can't get another year? I can't get my pro-style offense maybe installed with a better offensive line? You're going to put this all on me? Yeah, because now it's time to go. As people are really starting to look at Blake Baker, the defensive coordinator at Miami, and going, you know who might be a good fit for LSU? You know who might be a good fit for whomever, right? It would be Blake Baker, who was outstanding at La Tech. It's the reason he got the job over there at Miami. And to say nothing that Manny Diaz was also at La Tech there for a second. I like La Tech as a breeding ground for great coordinators. I'm not sure about head coaches, but great coordinators. Getting back to De'Ara King, I like how he's going to fit into this offense. I also wonder who he's going to be able to distribute the ball to in a meaningful way because guys like James Prochet don't know that you got one of those over there at Miami at present, right? Thought that guy was going to be KJ Osborne last year. Well, I'll have to wait and see who emerges, but we do know that they're going to try to throw the ball all up and down the yard because Gus Malzahn's offense doesn't really have, you know, slants and comebacks in it. It's got go routes and post routes, and every play is designed to go straight to the house. Now, the ACC is also, for me, a worse league than the American. The American was stout last year with not just, yes, Cincinnati and Memphis and SMU, but also throw in there when East Carolina was all right, they were all right. Central Florida was good. They won 10 games. Navy was really good. Tulane was good. I would take the American over the ACC right now, right? Outside of Clemson, who would you really trust? I think North Carolina could have a change year this year. This could be their magic year, but it is wide open for anybody not named Clemson to get into that ACC title game with them unless you're in their division, and then you're just kind of screwed. But De'Ara King picking Miami makes a lot of sense from the standpoint of does he want to get to the NFL as well? Because one thing we know about him is he needs to put together one more year of good tape that says that he could go into the NFL and be a capable starter instead of ending up as a wide receiver like some people are projecting him to be now. I'm not one of them, but to put it this way, when he was coming out of Manvel, Texas, and had passed for over 10,000 yards, rushed for over 3,000 yards as a quarterback, you know who recruited him to play slot and return kicks? Texas Christian. That's what Gary Patterson thought of De'Ara King's ability to play quarterback. Probably shows why he hasn't had a really great quarterback since Trayvon Boykin and why Max Duggan had to come to TCU and say, do you guys want to recruit me? Because I would really like to be there. And that's how they kind of fell into a blue chip recruit and Max Duggan being down there at Texas Christian, because we all know that Gary Patterson thinks about quarterbacks probably the way he thinks about offensive linemen. Anybody will do because he's a defensive-minded coach. But also, if you're going to go looking for players, maybe you want to go to Manvel because you know that Kyle Trask was backing up De'Ara King at Florida. And now he is the starter at Florida. Felipe Franks didn't even want to come back and compete with him. Tells you all you need to know. We'll see how this rounds out when we talk about whether or not Jeremiah Payton figures in, Mark Pope figures in a big way, and what this might mean for the offense in 2020. But again, I like it. I like the match of Lashlee and King, and I'm going to look forward to watching them play offensive football, especially if this offensive line is any good. All right, that's it for me. Doses.